everyone, my name is Ashish and you are watching another WebGuy YouTube channel, and I'm back with another video of CSS tutorial series. And today we are going to see some basic properties like colors, background and some typography. So without wasting any time, let's get started. If you have not yet subscribed to our channel, please hit the subscribe button and also the notification bell icon so that you don't miss any of our videos. So here you can see that I have created a index.html file and I have linked my style.css file in it, and inside this we have a div with class of box. So now we'll go on to our style.css file and we'll take our box class and we'll add the height and the width properties. The height and the width properties are used to set the height and width of the element. The height and the width properties do not include padding, borders or margin. It just sets the height or width of the area inside the padding, border and margin of an element. Now we'll give it a background color of red. Now here in CSS, a color can be specified by various methods. The first method is specifying by using the color name. CSS supports 140 standard color names, which you can see on the screen. So you can just type in the supported color name and we'll get the color. The next method is that you can use the hex number for the color. A hexadecimal color value is of the form #RRGGBB, where RR stands for the value of red, GG stands for the value of green, and BB stands for the value of blue. And they can take the values between 00 and FF, where FF is the hexadecimal equivalent of 255. So here we are setting it to #FF0000. It is displayed as red because red is set to its highest value and the others are set to its lowest value, that is 0. The next method for specifying colors is by using the RGB values. The RGB values can be specified by using RGB, and inside the bracket you define the intensity of red, green and blue color respectively between 0 and 255, where 0 is the lowest value and 255 is the highest value. So if you want to display red, we'll set the red to its maximum value, that is 255, and the green and blue to its minimum value, that is 0. Next we can have RGBA values. RGBA color values are just an extension of RGB color values with an alpha channel, which specifies the opacity of the color. So the red, green and blue remain same, and the alpha parameter is a number between 0, which is fully transparent, to 1, which is not transparent at all. Next we have HSL value, which stands for hue, saturation and lightness. Hue is the degree of color on the color wheel from 0 to 360, as you can see on the screen. 0 is red, 120 is green and 240 is blue. Saturation is the percentage value. 0% means a shade of gray and 100% is the full color. Lightness is also a percentage. 0% is black, 50% is neither black nor dark, and 100% is completely white. After that, similar to RGBA values, we have HSLA values, where A stands for the alpha channel and it can take value between 0 and 1, where 0 is fully transparent and 1 is not transparent at all. Talking of backgrounds, let's see what are the background properties that are used to define the background effects for elements. You have already seen how to use the background color property. The next we have background image property. It specifies an image to use as a background of the element. To specify the background image for a page or a particular element, just set its background image to URL and specify the path inside the brackets in quotes. Now by default, the image is repeated, so it covers the entire element. You can change this by using the background repeat property. It takes values like repeat x, repeat y and no repeat. In repeat x, the image will be repeated only horizontally, and in repeat y, The image will be repeated only vertically. Here we'll set it to no repeat. Next we have background position to specify the position of the background image. By default it is left top. We can change this to left. Next we have the background attachment property, which specifies whether the background image should scroll with the rest of the page or be fixed. So if you want it to scroll, just set scroll, which is also the default value, or you can set it to fixed. Now to shorten the code, it is also possible to specify these 5 background properties in one single property, and this is called a shorthand property. The shorthand property for background is just background. When using the shorthand property, the order of the property values should be background color, then background image, then background repeat, background attachment and background position. It does not matter if one of the property values is missing, as long as other values are in this order. One more property which is used a number of times is background size property, which is used to adjust the size of the background image. You can either set the size in pixels or you can use the keywords like cover or contain. If you will use contain, then it will resize the background image to make sure that the image is fully visible. And the cover will resize the background image to cover the entire container, even if it has to stretch the image or cut a little bit of one of the edges. So these were the major background properties which we'll be using all the time in our future videos. Now let's move on to some of the important text formatting properties. For that I'm going to add a p element with a class of text, and here I'll write lorem 20 to generate 20 random words. Now let's move on to a css and select the text class. We can set the text color by using the color property. Then text align property is used to set the horizontal alignment of the text. It can take values like left, right, center or justified. Then we have the text decoration property. It is used to set or remove decorations from the text. We can use it to underline some portion of text, or it is often used to remove underlines from links. To remove the underlines, just set the text decoration value to none. Next we have the text transform property, and it is used to specify uppercase and lowercase letters in a text. We'll set this to capitalize, that means it will capitalize first letter of each word. Then we have text indent property, and it is used to specify the indentation of the first line of text. We can also set the space between the characters in our text by using the letter spacing property. Then you can specify the space between the words in your text by using the word spacing property. We can also add shadow by using the text shadow property. It takes three values. The first value represents the horizontal position, the second value represents the vertical position of the shadow, and the third value represents the color of the shadow. You can also change the font of your text by using the font family property. Now in CSS we have two types of font families. One is the generic family and the other is the specific font family. Generic families are a group of font families with a similar look. In total we have three generic families, which are serif, sans serif and monospace. The serif fonts have small lines at the end of some characters and in sans serif you will not see these lines, and monospace characters have the same width. In general, on computer screens, sans serif fonts are considered easier to read. We'll also see how we can use Google Fonts to change the specific font family. For that, just go to Google, type Google Fonts. Here, select any font which you like. After that, click on this tab. Now, as you can see, copy this link tag and paste it into the head section of your HTML document as instructed here. Now you will be able to use this font as your specific font family. The font family property holds several font names as a fallback system, so if in case your browser does not support the first font, it tries the next font and so on. So generally you should have the generic family at the end so that the browser picks a similar font in the generic family if no other fonts are available. Last but not the least, you can change the size of your text by using the font size property. That's all for today. See you next week. Thank you for watching the video. Please hit the like button if you learned something. If you're new here, consider subscribing. See you in the next video. Till then, take care. Bye-bye.